Well, good afternoon, everyone, and good morning to those of us joining from any of the European time zones. This is the seventh session in our bi-monthly Singapore Declares and Shares series. In the way of a brief introduction, Construction Declares is an online petition uniting all strands of construction and the built environment. It was started in May 2019 and has over 9,200 signatories now in various disciplines and in 27 countries around the globe. And the number of professionals engaged in the signatory companies hovers around 1 million employees. In early January 2020, Singapore joined in the movement with both Singapore architects and Singapore structural engineers doing the initial declarations. And in June 2020, we set up the Singapore and the Global Environmental Consultants Declare platform, which means that any environmental consultant across the globe who wishes to join will be helped by us. About the same time, the Singapore landscape architects joined the declaration. And so we now have a total of 54 Singapore-based signatories with over 50,000 professionals. So welcome everybody to this session. And for this session, we have three prolific speakers. We've got Tolga Coskun, Sri Gopalakrishnan, and Leonard Ng. And we have Sarah Ichioka as our moderator. Sarah is the director of Desire Lines Private Limited. Her book Flourish, Design Paradigms for Our Planetary Emergency, co-authored with Michael Porwell, will be published by Triaki Press in September. Without further ado, I'll pass over the session to our moderator, Sarah, to introduce our speakers.
Thank you so much, Richard, and thank you to the organizers of this session on three interlinked and incredibly important topics of ecology, biodiversity, and resilience. Since the majority of our speakers and myself are based in Singapore, and I understand that a large percentage of the audience are dialing in from Singapore, I wanted to emphasize the resilience in solidarity with everyone who is just about to enter our third phase of lockdown. And we appreciate you very much joining us today. I couldn't think of three better speakers to have a lively and well-informed conversation about these topics. I might introduce all three of them as we just up front, and then they will hand over to one another. They'll each take about 8 minutes to present, leaving at least 20 juicy minutes for us to have a Q&A with you, the audience. So please pay careful attention to what they say and prepare some great questions that you can share with us in the Q&A box for discussion at the end of the session. So joining us today, we have Tolga Coskun, who is director of the Gondwana initiative at Arpastrons, a biodiversity manager based in France. Hello, Tolga. We'll have Srilalitha Gopalakrishnan, who wears multiple hats. She's president of the Singapore Institute of Landscape Architects on a mission to get more of her members to sign up to the declaration. You're on notice. And a PhD candidate in architecture and sustainable design at SUTD. And finally, we'll be hearing from Leonard Ng, who really needs little introduction to this audience. He's partner at RSD and country director for Ramble in Singapore. I'm really looking forward to hearing from these three speakers and engaging in discussion with them. Tolga, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sarah, and hello to everybody. I will just share my slides. Yes, that's perfect. Please just tell me if you have a problem. Today, I think we all know that biodiversity is a big concern because it is eroding at a never seen speed. And it is the responsibility of everybody personally and every sector professionally to fight against this erosion. And of course, the building industry as well and the city in its whole. But this being said, what is really urban biodiversity, or what is really biodiversity in the built environment in particular? We hear a lot of concepts like urban agriculture, biophilia, greenery, nature in the city, gardens. So a lot of concepts, and it's sometimes difficult to understand what is what. So I wanted here today as an ecologist to give you a scientific insight to put some hierarchy between those key subjects. First of all, the main subjects when we do ecology, the mother of all, it's the ecosystems. The ecosystems and urban ecosystem in our case. The ecosystems are the interaction between species, between each other, and with their environment. So all the functioning ecosystems depends of those interactions. I want to give you an example here. Those interactions could be, I cannot change. Oh yeah, that's perfect. All those interactions could be, of course, parasitism, hunting, hiding, and the most important interaction at all for the sustainability of life is the reproduction. Unlike in zoos, where we sustain animals by feeding them and giving them comfort in exchange of liberty, in ecosystems, species have to sustain by themselves and find spaces where they can do all their functions. I want to show this example, this great example of hornbill. After they disappeared from Singapore, they have been heavily reintroduced in the island with a lot of five-star nests around the island. And we can see here that this hornbill preferred the HDB than all the bird's nests that are at his disposal. So what I wanted to say here is that designing ecosystems is essential, and landscapes and architects have a lot of to do. But when it comes to nature, we have to accept that observation and adaptations are very important, because nature doesn't work always like we expected. And this is why working with ecologists is very important. After the ecosystems, I want to show another example of design. Here is a building that we built with a worldwide logistic company in Singapore. It's a five-story warehouse, and we created a pond on the rooftop. And this pond, I wanted to show you how it worked after a few days after the delivery of this pond. And I hope you can see the dragonflies on this video that are already colonizing the pond. And of course, wetlands are a big issue in Singapore because of mosquitoes, so it is a serious issue. But finally, mosquitoes stand no chance here, because I don't know if you know this, but dragonfly larvae are eating mosquito larvae in the water, and dragonfly adults are eating mosquito adults in the air. So they really stand no chance. And all the time, this wetland will be functional. There will be no mosquitoes on this pond. So this is what we call an ecosystemic service. So the functioning of these ecosystems brings us some services. And here the service is a regulation of mosquitoes. The pond is the source of the mosquitoes, but it's also the solution because it is functioning. And which is great is that we can mimic those ecosystem services to achieve a target we want. This is what we call nature-based solutions. We can use, I showed this example again, we can design ecosystem services. Here, for example, in an empiric way, we used domestic cats to pest control for thousands of years. And today we know that we can design those ecosystem services. An example here with climate change, we know that we will have more and more heat waves, sadly, and tree shades are a nature-based solution we are using more and more for the resilience of the city. We can also create nature-based solutions for stormwater management, for tsunami control. That's what we are they are doing in Bangladesh, for example, by creating more and more mangroves, or in the north of Singapore as well, by the way. So we can almost achieve any target, any resilience target, by nature-based solutions. So this is also an important role for biodiversity. And finally, we will have a lot of indirect benefits for urban dwellers in the city by these nature-based solutions, but we can have also direct benefits by health and well-being. Here, I'm really sorry for my poor skills in Photoshop, but I couldn't show those people's faces without their consent. But here is in the Blue Hub again, the same project, the warehouse project I showed previously. And this here, we have a perfect example of biophilic design. We are not really outside, but we are not really inside neither. And this is a great comfort zone provided by this greenery, lush greenery. So as a conclusion, I would say that the more biodiversity we have in the city, the more functioning ecosystems we have, and the more resilient will be our cities, and the more healthy and happy urban dwellers can be. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tolga. So I guess, Sarah, I continue from here, right?
Yes, please.
I think it's just nice that Tolga has introduced the most common terms, which I would also be talking about in my presentation. So hello, everybody. Thank you for the introduction, Sarah and Richard, and also the opportunity to be part of this sharing series. Allowed on what the shift to embrace where ecology, environment, and people can thrive. So as a profession, landscape architecture sits at an intersection of environmental consciousness, ecological sensitivities, and also science-based applied technologies, encompassing the elements of art, environment, ecology, architecture, sociology, and engineering. We often pride ourselves as a multidisciplinary profession that focuses on nurturing both the built and the natural environment, and finding the delicate balance where they become mutually beneficial. In Singapore, the practice of landscape architecture, the practice of landscape architecture saw significant shifts as urban developments intensify, densities increase, built environments extend vertically, and public and open spaces actually stretch from ground level infrastructure to elevated social spaces in the sky. So integrating extensive greenery as an effective mean to achieve a highly livable, attractive, and ecologically balanced city, strengthen this biophilic nature-based approach to designing and planning of urban spaces here. So as we accelerate our journey to transform the identity of Singapore as a little red dot to this big green dot, the shift is really next to conserve and enhance both the natural and built environments, and to make each urban space a significant socio-ecological node. What it means is we really need to look at the entire city as an urban ecosystem where humans become an integral part of nature. And both these social and ecological processes occur within a spatial context, right? Within a spatial system. So the urban planning requires a very logical and scientific approach to integrate spatial logic with the socio-ecological systems. So what do we look at when we say spatial layers in this whole integration? So if you look at a scale of nature to urban, where the nature talks about high ecological value and the urban end talks about high social value, we have a very distinct spatial layers or spatial components we design. So there is the protected core nature reserves, which is of very high ecological value because of sensitive ecosystems. We want to preserve them, conserve them, and have very little or limited interactions. However, we can stretch the social value of it through educational programs with very minimal interactions. The next layer is, of course, the linear connectors or the arteries of the nature ways, which we call them. So they become like the access ways or flows for people, activities, and also for animals, plants, and different biotopes. So they kind of stretch both directions. So there is a high social value, but it also offers a high ecological value. The active ground plane is where diversity of functions happens, where the social and ecological layers actually connect and interact. So while traditionally these have been tilted more towards the social value, increasingly we are able to stretch its ecological value through curated ecosystems and integrating ecosystem services into all these diverse hues. And finally, we do have these performative buildings, right? Where we intensify these processes within the technical and programmatic aesthetics of a building. So this one is definitely more tilted towards the high social value. Traditionally, we say that they are very poor in ecological value. However, it also has a good opportunity to have a layer of blue-green infrastructure, adding more biodiversity. So all these kind of give us opportunities to extend its ecological value as well. And the most critical part between all this is strengthening the connectivity. I think independently they all work, but based on my own research and based on different researches which I have been involved in, there are high value in strengthening connectivity, whether it's at the ground level or whether it's at the vertical plane. So every space we design needs to stretch the obvious and push the ecological boundaries. So this is not new. In Singapore, we have excellent examples which are successful, like the Kranji marshes or Sungai Buloh, where successful restorations saw thriving wildlife and biodiversity, but it also strengthened the social value through integrated education programs. Another very interesting example, which is also something I was working on, is the Likongtian Natural History Museum, where an extremely small footprint of urban greenery can still be effectively curated to show native habitats and also engage visitors on conversations of biodiversity, environment, and conservation. So thus, there is enough opportunity for us to stretch. So how do we really push these boundaries, right? What does it entail for us going forward? The most important thing is to educate ourselves, improve our understandings of what these entail, make sure that we educate not just ourselves, educate our collaborators, our users, our stakeholders, and also actively test each of these aspects in our projects, in small scale to a larger scale, and of course, continue dialogues. The other one is to, of course, have performance-based landscape design solutions. So that means we have to engage in a more scientific approach, a research-driven approach to design, such that we are able to quantify the performance of the projects. This is something which I'm personally involved in. I'm invested as a researcher, and there are interesting findings, which I would love to share in another platform in future. And of course, finally, it is really the adoption of a whole systems approach to landscape design. I think we really need to make that shift from doing less bad to doing more good, which is really what regenerative design approach talks about. So we have to look at something where our design solutions are able to transform positively, not just for the socio-economic and ecological systems for the site itself, but also beyond the project and beyond the sites. So it is indeed timely that Singapore landscape architects have actually declared and signed the climate and biodiversity emergency. And as an institute, I think SILA is really committed to assist the practices in educating, engaging, embracing this whole systems approach to various platforms, whether it is webinars, whether it is publications, whether it's knowledge repository. And as Sarah had initially mentioned, we do have 6 practices which have come on board, and we really aspire that all 26 practices in Singapore join, and we can have a more collective voice going forward on this. Thank you.
Thanks, Sri. Leonard, you're up.
Thanks, Sri, for sharing. Let me share my screen, please. Sorry, do you see it?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Sri, for sharing your thoughts on how landscape architects can play a role. And I think it is timely and it does deal very well with my chat, which is really talking about our first project in Singapore under Rambo Studio Dry Cycle, which is a Bishan Amukyo Park. It's been 10 years since it's completed. And I thought it was a good time to look back and see what it has accomplished and what else can we do going forward. So Bishan Park was a pilot project out of this initiative called ABC Waters, launched by POB prior to 2008. And it was really about changing mindsets, right? Making people aware of our water as natural resources, right? And enhancing the value of green and blue infrastructure in Singapore. So Bishan Park was originally a 65-hectare park with a 3-kilometer-long concrete canal, right? And the whole idea was, why not make better use of this waterway by converting it into a natural river use it to meet the community with the recreational areas. And therefore, we came up with this concept of creating this new whole river system with floodplains, right, that has got multifunctional values for the community. I want to play you a short video of a user who has documented this project. special thanks to the a member of the public, Bryce Lee, who allowed me to share this video. He's a passionate nature lover, right? And he took hand and he documented this construction and evolution of the park over a 10-year period. So, you know, this picture was taken a while back by Jason Kwar SD Photos. And I think it was taken during the height of the COVID-19 pandemic. And really, it highlights the value of parks and nature networks, right, for our mental well-being, mental and physical well-being. So after saying that, you know, having a design like this is not static. It's unlike a building. It is constantly changing and evolving. For example, this table that was shared by Professor Huang from NUS. And it documents the change in the species richness and vegetation area over time, right? The landscape is constantly evolving, right? And you see from these pictures from inception to 2018, how the vegetation and soilscape has really evolved. And it's really about understanding how to manage change as designers and as decline. How do we accept that the landscape is constantly changing, and how do we appreciate that and understand that when we are constantly maintaining it? So having a proper training regime will help us maintain the vision for this project. For example, this plan on top shows in 2011 and 2018 how it has changed through time, right? But you see that the maintenance regime has actually modified the way the space is used. Now you, previously you can approach the water, now you are segregated from the water. And spaces for nature, right? There are obviously a lot more nature there now. They have recorded much more bird species and insects and plants. But are we ready to accept them? Recently debate, you know, where otters, there's now a proliferation of otters within an island, but they're hearing increasingly complaints about otters and their role within our environment, right? If you look at the chat groups now, it was just everybody was, you know, really enamored with otters, but now there's a wider and wider voice that is asking for control. So are we ready for a greater infusion of green and blue infrastructure and its consequences? Another one is creating awareness, right? This picture from SD Times showing what the Bishan River during a storm event. It was a good thing that there's a lot of public in the public defending this, saying that it is actually part of the design, but there's greater need to educate and make people aware actually of the purpose of this such designs. And then finally, it's about shared ownership. We create beautiful spaces. We create beautiful, sustainable, ecological spaces. But as a member of the community, we need to play our part, right? We need to work on the software after that will complement the hardware. So I think in view of that, moving from this to this is a journey, right? But that doesn't end at the inception of the project. It continues, both for us as individuals and as part of the community. With that, thank you. I'll hand over to Sarah.
Thank you, Leonard, and thank you. Thanks to all of our panelists. I really appreciate the way that all three of you managed to reflect on these quite complex and large issues in a very practical way that to me suggests a positive way forward. I think what I wanted to start off with, I'll ask a few questions and would love to hear more questions from the audience. If you could please drop them in the Q&A rather than in the chat box, that'll help us keep track of them more efficiently. Thank you. In the context of this conversation, right, which is framed as under the umbrella of a declaration of climate emergency, I wanted to get a bit of a temperature check from all three of you based on your experience. If we've touched on, you know, how the designer or the professional, shall we say, since we always also have an ecologist, how the professional interfaces with the client and the public. To what extent do you feel that all three of those pieces of the equation have acknowledged and are acting as if we are in an emergency? What's your sense? Who is furthest ahead of those three? And what needs to be done to catch up? Sri, do you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think it's kind of a very, very relevant question we need to ask ourselves. You know, like I do see that we as the professionals have already understood the emergency, you know, the need for us to really start, doing well what we are saying, you know. The public, I think it's kind of, this is my sense, that the public is really like a wave. When things like flooding happens or, you know, temperatures rise, there is this heated conversation about climate change and the need to adopt practices which are more climate friendly. But, you know, as things come back to normal, the conversations kind of die down, the motivation levels kind of drop, you kind of try to get back to what you are more comfortable with. When it comes to the owners or the developers or our clients, I think there is a significant level of awareness, especially in Singapore. I think every client values what this conversation on sustainability or ecology is about. So I would say the clients are fairly well informed, and they are willing to make those changes and invest in it. Compared to, I think the public, I think will come along. Even, you know, when we started looking at greenery or biodiversity or, sky rise, green walls and everything. So it took a while for public to see the value of it. So we do have a little bit of way to go on that front. Yeah.
Thank you. Tolga, since I know that you operate within a larger development firm, I wondered if you could give comment maybe more from the client perspective, and also if you wanted to bring a European perspective to the conversation too. I know you've worked in Singapore extensively, but I'd love to hear if you see a difference between the two regions.
I really believe that we entered an acceleration moment the past year, probably because of the COVID crisis. But not only, because we had a 10-year of scientific construction of climate change facts, and today I think everybody believes that the climate change is real and biodiversity loss is real as well. And this really started to accelerate this year, and I can see it with all major clients, all major politics as well. And in the European context, we have a special accelerator as well with the European Commission, who's working on what we call taxonomy, which is to target investment, financial investment, only on sustainable actives or assets. And this will be a game changer for Europe, where no investment can be done, including urban projects, without proving sustainability, climate sustainability and biodiversity sustainability, but also social sustainability. And we are expecting this to be ready in 2022, and this will really be a game changer. And I want to add something personal as well. Sarah, you asked who is more advanced in this awareness, and I would say that it's kids. Kids are sadly the most advanced and aware of the danger. And When I'm talking to politicians, local politicians, and or even for clients, I'm telling them, okay, your customers, maybe it's not an element of choice when they buy something or when they buy housing, when they vote on a local election, but the kids now, which will be the consumers in few years, or the voters, citizens in few years, they will make their vote or their buyings with real evidence of sustainability from your actions. And this will be also a game changer. It just needs a few years to wait for the kids to grow.
Thanks, Tolga. And I feel that so many young people have put their careers and their sometimes their bodies physically on the line to open up the space for those of us who are active professionals in position of relative power to act. And I think it's actually unethical if we don't take that opportunity, especially some of them are dedicating their lives to the fight before they can even vote, right? Leonard, I was really struck by, obviously there's huge public passion for your project, right? That these amateur filmmakers and photographers would dedicate a full decade to following it and documenting it. And also wanted to acknowledge the fact that I know that you work with a lot of the government agencies here. So I wondered if you could share your perspective on this, maybe from more of a public sector perspective, as well as a public mindset perspective.
Sure. I think to the Singapore government's credit, they have been one of the champions for this climate change issue. Last few years, they have actually defined the problems and they have written a roadmap how they want to move ahead. And they're actually one of the first movers to push for forward-looking plans. And I think that's really to be commended because, especially from Singapore point of view, as a nation due to our low-lying land, we are actually especially vulnerable to climate change. And I think they are aware of that. This for us is really a threat to our livelihood, right? It's not just a theoretical problem, it's a threat to our livelihood. So they're taking this seriously. Unfortunately, I don't see the same urgency, right, from some members of the profession, right? Sometimes it's easy to forget daily, when you're doing things. Right, that this is a problem that needs to be focused on, right? And especially the clients, right? Clients, a lot of them, they are driven by different KPIs. They are answerable to their shareholders, right? And everything has got to have a commercial rationale, and it's difficult to give you a commercial justification, right? When you're saying that climate change is gonna be a threat to us 10 years from now, 15 years from now, it is this undefined and so-called problem that they don't really have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. So the government is championing it. We really need to, I think all of us need to feel the same urgency as they do.
Thank you. Before I take the first question from the audience, and I hope there'll be more as well, I wanted to address that business mentality, right? Like, got to return value to your shareholders, et cetera. And wondered what arguments one might put forward when faced with that mentality. Tolga, I know, for example, I believe your business is registered as a B Corp. Do I understand that right? Could you share perhaps how that registration has changed the way you take decisions within the company, and also the way you converse with clients about some of these KPIs that may perhaps be at odds with some of the ecological goals that the panel has raised?
Leading this certification, B Corp certification, we had to change our way of talking to all our stakeholders, internal and external. I think that we had to make some choices as a company, as a business unit, to continue earning our lives and earning some money, but to redirect our activities on sustainable practices. And we could do it on our own, on a maybe a strategic level with few people. But we, the B Corp, pushed us to do it with every employee of the company on a global level. And this was really a game changer, because maybe we went a little bit further than we could do by ourselves, because you always have a fear of the change, which is human, I think. And we went a little bit far. We don't know yet all the consequences of this. I really believe it will be positive. So this is great. And we change also in our way of working with our stakeholders, because we choose more our clients, we choose more our advisors or other companies. We don't work with companies that can't justify, show evidence of sustainability in practices, with good wages for everybody, and etc. So yes, this is really a game changer. And we also work more with our clients that are also B Corp certified. So we start an ecosystem of better practices, and which is the beginning of change.
Wonderful, thank you. And if I can give a plug, although I'm in no way affiliated with the B Corps movement, it's actually registered in Singapore now, and there are a lot of live ambassadors here. If anyone on the call is interested, whether you're a CELA member, SIA member, et cetera, I know that they're very, very keen to recruit more meaningful business engagement here in Singapore. All right, moving to our first question from the audience, someone is asking, we often talk about ecological and nature-based solutions in terms of design and ecosystem services, but what about the construction phase and the O&M phase? What kind of sustainable solutions can be considered for these? I'll open the floor to anyone who wants to answer.
Maybe I can ask a question to answer the question, but I believe that this person tried to say to ask the impact of construction materials, maybe the concrete, and if it is the question, then it is a very difficult question, because we know that I'm not expert on this, so I will not talk long about this question, but this is a real issue to know how we can sustainably continue to construct, to find concrete without emptying all the oceans of the world and all the wetlands, because this is generally where we find elements for the concrete. Even if we would construct wood with wood everywhere, we wouldn't have enough forest around the globe. So that's an unsolved issue, sadly.
Thank you. And I know that Dr. Hussein Rezai, who's one of the founders of this series, has been a very strong advocate for reuse of existing buildings as one of the ways to deal with this. And I actually wanted to extend that question to whether, Sri or Leonard, do you have any examples of work that you've done with renovated buildings where you were able to incorporate new ecosystem services, landscape, et cetera, that you think might answer this question?
Yeah, for citing the example of Bishan Park, what we did was we recycled the concrete that we harvested from the old canal. We took it all up, we crushed it up, and we used to bed the river. And we tried to do that with all our projects as much as possible, try to use locally sourced projects, which in Singapore context may be a bit more difficult, but I think it's possible in many, many countries, or try to use materials with a low carbon footprint. But with respect to the question specifically about the maintenance phase, I think we can definitely evaluate the way we do maintenance from landscape. Last year was a classic example during the COVID-19, right? Everybody was shut down. all the parks and street edges were not trimmed, right? And they were allowed to grow wild, but were we worse off for it? I mean, soon after, when I had the chance to go out and walk and look at some of this untrimmed streetscape, they didn't look any worse. In fact, in many instances, they looked better, right? And the biodiversity flourished, the butterflies, the bees were in profusion. So I think there is definitely rationale to reevaluate the way we maintain our public spaces, right? Maybe we don't need such high maintenance. Maybe we allow, you know, nature to take its course, right? We'll save money, we'll improve biodiversity, and we consume less energy.
Beautifully said. And I thought that was a thread that ran across all three of your presentations, as sort of a challenge to your fellow designers to think about. How do you accept that observation and adaptation are very important skills? You know, how do you think along the spectrum that Sri shared? How do you think about managing change? So we have another question that's specifically interested in that charming Hornbill HDB video. And I think I know they're asking, was the structure planned? What was the idea behind it? I believe that it was a squatter case, right? They just adopted an airbed. But perhaps, Sri, do you have any examples of people adapting design and landscape discoveries like this?
I think during my time with Tierra Design, we did one of the projects, which was actually, it became a flagship for Skyrise Greenery at one time. It was really a very, very small office building atrium, which was facing the main street, but it really was lifeless. The land value, the property value was very low, although it was in the prime district. And we worked with another architect to actually refurbish the entire atrium into a garden, you know, a vertical garden. And it was not about taking or bringing in new things inside, but it was really like using beams, the columns, the structures, which were already existing within that atrium space and adapting them to create this new garden experience. So, you know, you kind of added very simple mesh kind of covers over the beams to create planters, which can be accessible. And then using these large columns along the walls to support this vertical, it's I think about a 6-7 story vertical green wall. And interestingly, once this was done, the property value really increased. So many of the clients wanted to take up the floor space there. You could see birds coming in. You could actually have some bit of life within the dead building. So it's possible. I think it takes a bit of effort. It takes from all parties. You know, it's not just the consultant teams, but also the stakeholders, you know, to kind of embrace the value of retaining and reusing the spaces. Yeah, so it is feasible. It is really possible. It really is about changing that mindset.
I really appreciate about all of you the fact that you are able to share this really practical knowledge that gives hope. We have a question, another question from the audience from Victoria, who's sharing her perception of nature-based solutions being mostly complex and requiring expert knowledge from multiple fields. So she's asking, how can we avoid that these issues are and solutions are recognized and discussed only in elite groups? I don't know, is this an elite group? You're quite elite. And instead be brought to engage the general wider public.
If I may go first, I don't think, I mean, at least based on my own experience, I don't think these conversations are any more limited to an elite group. I think these conversations are happening at multiple levels, at the ground level, you know, with average public, to the highest level who make these policies and who are legislating these changes. I mean, in my own, in my complex, in the condominium where I stay, you know, we have this entire community, which is like, it's like a chat group, you know, where they all talk about, there is this sense of sharing, people don't want to waste things. So you don't kind of throw and buy, you are able to exchange. There are conversations about recycling. There are conversations about, you know, gardening, community, aspirations of becoming more environment friendly. So I do think that all these are happening, you know, at ground. It is no more limited to elite groups, which is what we perceive. But I think there is this shift. And as Tolga mentioned, I think it's also the last year has also accelerated this whole conversation. You know, more and more people are aware about their surroundings, about what happens, and you know how their actions are making changes to what is happening around them. So I think there is a heightened sense of responsibility slowly coming in, which has accelerated last year. But I think if we are able to really keep that momentum going and tap into it and not let it, like, you know, fall back to normalcy or, you know, to what you're comfortable with, we are on the right path, I would say. It's no more elite in my view. It's no more elite.
Thank you. That's really heartening. And I think it's one of the advantages of having a relatively long-lived population as well, that I feel that Singapore's silver generation has such an important role to play, almost as the bridge, right, of people who may have grown up much closer to nature, much more familiar with the names of plants, animals, etc., and with a memory. And I think that it's brilliant that, yes, Sri, I feel like government discourse has even started to acknowledge that, for example, like making a statement that Singapore's Karangunis have a role to play in the circular economy, right? It's not just the high tech example. But Leonard, you did, you know, you shared some hard truths with us as well. You know, for example, the case of the otters, going from love to maybe something less than love. Do you have any examples of, say, peer-to-peer learning or the creation of community groups that you feel have been effective in continuing to lead the positive conversation about ecological coexistence?
I think there are many groups in Singapore that plays that role. All right, the nature groups, all the different nature groups, the Friends of the Otter Society and stuff like that. But, you know, there's this group of nature lovers, right? And then there's the general public, right? And unfortunately, sometimes they are conflicting perspectives, right? And it is an ongoing educational process. Right? I think we as a society need to mature, right? We need to ask ourselves what's important for us, right? And if it's important, then we need to really see how we can learn to live with whatever is important for us. All right. But the trend is towards a greater embrace of nature, right? You see from the dialogues, every time there's a what perceived to be a non-nature friendly initiative, right? The nature groups will be out of arms. But you know, it's important to really be able to take each other's perspective, right? Because in a society and in an island in Singapore where there's limited land, right, there need to be a realization that there is there's always compromise, right? Finding a balance between the needs of the different groups, and I think that's where these nature groups can play a role, right? Try to champion the nature causes, they nonetheless need to take a balanced view, right? And not be overly just focusing on the nature part with no consideration about the needs of the society. And similarly for the rest of the public who's only concerned about the koi fishes being eaten alive, without understanding that, you know, if you want nature, this is part of the ecosystem, you have to live with otters. Right, so everybody has a role to play. That's my final response.
Just one small interesting anecdote to add. You know, I was in this group discussion where I was sitting along with these wildlife, people who work with wildlife mapping, you know, in Singapore. And I was sharing about how during these COVID times, we all discovered the value of small pockets of greenery at our backyards, which we would have never seen otherwise, you know, just because you couldn't move to a larger radius. So you kind of explore every bit of land around you, and then you discover these interesting green reserves, which can be actively used, you know. And then they had their own viewpoint. They said, yeah, yeah, people went into those places and, you know, disturbed the entire terrestrial wildlife. So I was like, oh, okay, you know, so it's interesting to see, you know, how the perspectives of looking at this. So for us, I looked at it as a very positive way, in the sense, like, you know, you are able to discover and appreciate, whereas for them, it was like a not so good development, right? So that is where I meant when I said you need to have this balance of socio-ecological process. So that means we need to understand that while the ecological values are important, as a city, we also need to acknowledge that the social component is equally important. So we have to balance the two, you know, you cannot just focus on one at the expense of the other. Yeah.
And I mean, maybe there's a role to play. I know you're, as you finish your PhD, but I think there's a role for some to play in helping to think about how to not phrase everything as a trade-off. I feel like that's a really common,
attitude.
A really, really common rhetorical inheritance in the Singaporean context that you don't necessarily hear in other places. And I know that has specific geographic and political context, but I think that there's also a role for, you know, bright people like the three of you to play in reframing that conversation, but not necessarily seeing the two in conflict. You know, Tolga, I think of that beautiful rooftop where it's great for the dragonflies and it's great for the people on their coffee breaks, right? So we are running close to time. The number has been hanging in my head from Richard's introduction when he mentioned that construction declares now, I think, numbers 1 million members globally. And Leonard, you ended your last statement by saying we all have a role to play. So I think that most of our audience members are wearing a professional hat today. And I wondered if you wanted to address the audience and share your one thought of if they could go and do one thing in their professional, wearing the professional hat, in this summer, say by the end of August, given that we have 8 years left to avert climate disaster, no pressure, what would you encourage them to do? What positive action would you encourage them to take?
So in the professional capacity, you said, Sarah?
Yes, I think if you feel really strongly moved to talk in another capacity, but the first question was professional.
I think we just have to be mindful about the consequences of our design decisions, right? We need to be aware what it means for society, for community, and for our environment, right? And make sure you make the right decisions. Too often I see designers design pretty things with no consideration for what it means for society or for the environment, right? And I think as designers, we owe it to ourselves to be a bit deeper thinking in the way we do our design.
So I think I also kind of agree with Leonard. I think we don't need to do, I think one thing which I want to leave everybody with is that you don't need to do big statements, you know, to make this change. You can do it at even a small scale. You know, even if you're doing a small space, think about what more can this space be, you know, other than the obvious. I think, as I said in my presentation, you need to stretch beyond the obvious. What can I do beyond what is obviously going to do, you know, and make sure that there is a sense of connectivity between every space you design. You know, don't look at them as isolation. Don't look at them only in your project. Look at the edges, look at the larger connections, you know. So I think really this idea of ensuring that there's always the sense of connectivity. Your project is not in isolation. It is part of a larger system. So do every small action will kind of, you know, contribute in the larger scale. So I think for me, that is really important. Don't think it's a big statement you need to make. It's the small things you do in your project, which will make the difference.
Yeah. That times a million, right?
Yeah.
Do you have a thought to share before we hand over to Richard for his final thought?
Sorry, I didn't hear you well, sorry. I wanted to share with you the results of a study in New York in 2015 that studied the breaks to a mass implementation of green infrastructures. And the results were very interesting because the real breaks were not financial or technical, but they were human and management related. So as professionals, we have all to be not small breaks of the system, but we have to be slopes for the system to accelerate and redirect. I really believe that we can change, not by like being heroes, but being small accelerators of the system.
Thank you all so much for sharing those thoughts. Richard, can we hand over to you for some closing thoughts?
Thank you, Sarah. That was very beautifully moderated. Much appreciate. And thanks to Tolga and Sri and Leonard for some really fascinating insights. And I just wanted to finish up with the audience. I think, again, a small step. I've actually started using Singapore Declares as a tool, not just a platform, but so with my clients actually saying, oh, I'm a signatory to SG Declares. Did you know I feel duty bound to tell you that we should be doing these kind of moves and measures? And actually it's very effective. It makes it not personal. It makes clients feel like they're not up to date if they're contradicting SG Declares. Recently I was sharing with One Singh and Hussein like last week with the development, 250 apartments. You know, there was this conversation, should there be gas water heaters or electrical, you know, and I said, look, SG Declares, we've got to be sustainable. If we go for electric heat pumps, we can also sign up for a green energy supplier, you know, but if we go gas, we're pumping out CO2 for the next 50 years, you know, for 250 homes. And they went, oh, really? What's the cost difference? Oh, it's a bit more expensive. But, you know, they felt really good about making the decision. It wasn't personal. It wasn't me making a fuss. You know, they only needed a little push. And so I think that's a good lesson for everyone, I think, who's a signatory or thinking about it, is, just stepping up and making the conversation in a normal coordination meeting can make a huge difference. So I do encourage you all to do that. So thanks, everybody. And I did also want to say thanks to Wan Singh, who organizes these events. She's always hiding behind the red globe on the picture, but she does a fantastic job. And this is a great community. I think an example of systems thinking again, where we're all making these small connections, sharing things, making projects, every little step of the way, we're getting somewhere. And I think it accelerates faster and faster. So thanks, everybody. Have a great week. And bye-bye.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Take care.